Welcome to Former Adventist Podcast. I'm Nikki Stevenson.
And I'm Colleen Tinker.
Today we're going to take a little bit of a break from the passage of Revelation, but we're still going to be talking about heaven. And if you've been following us through this series on the book of Revelation, you know that we have been walking through this really supported by the teaching of Pastor Carey in his Revelation series for the Word Search Bible Study Ministry. Mm-hmm. And he decided he was going to take a quick break to talk about heaven. We've decided to follow along with this because he raises some really important questions, especially for people who've come out of Seventh-day Adventism, but not excluding all believers, especially right. In the climate that we live in today. So we are going to be talking about heaven, and we're going to be asking three questions about heaven. And the first question is, how do we learn about heaven? Mm-hmm. And so my question to you, Colleen, before we jump into this, is as an Adventist, how did you learn about heaven?
Well, I think the biggest way I can remember learning about heaven was in the Bible storybooks, the Uncle Arthur Bible storybooks, and the pictures, The Adventist art in those Bible storybooks. Now, I think subsequent generations had other books that came that were written a little later after the Arthur Maxwell series, but the Arthur Maxwell series is still a classic, and often you'll find copies of them or certain volumes of them in doctor's office waiting rooms and so forth. So they're still around. But those pictures, that's how I really remember what I first understood about heaven. Oh, I remember pictures of the sea of glass. I remember pictures of the tree of life. I remember pictures of the animals lying in the grass together. There was also a picture somewhere, I don't think it was in the book, of that little girl sitting on Jesus' lap going, "What happened to your hand?" And we've mentioned that before and how our friend Cheryl Granger said, a little girl in heaven would not be asking Jesus, "What happened to your hand?" Or she wouldn't be there because she would know what happened to his hand to be there. There were those kinds of things. And I don't remember specifically. My general sea of memories is of those pictures and those books. And probably Sabbath school lessons. Mm. What about you, Nikki? How did you learn about heaven?
Well, there's just this one picture in my head that came from those Bible storybooks, and it's a beautiful garden and Jesus and children. So I had that setting in my head for what heaven was. And there might have been a painting that included like a castle-like thing.
Oh, I think there was, yes.
That was really pretty.
Yeah,
kind
of
almost glowing.
Uh-huh.
So I kind of had that idea in my head about heaven at a young age. But to be honest with you, I think heaven was always just something that I would pontificate about.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when I'm in heaven, I want to do this or I want to do that. Or do you think when we're in heaven that we'll be able to like fly, or will we just be able to transport to other places? And then someone would chime in with, well, Ellen White said we're going to be able to visit other planets. And so, you know, a lot of dialogue with other Adventists, a lot of guessing and wondering, just a lot of pontificating. And then the setting was kind of fixed by the art.
Right. You know, that's true. That's true. It was for me too. The setting was fixed by the art.
I did recently hear from someone that Ellen White had a vision in which she saw a large banquet table in heaven. And so I don't know if that somehow got down to me through oral tradition when I was growing up. Didn't know that that came from Ellen. I didn't know what the Bible said about heaven versus what Ellen said. Mm-hmm. I was an adult saying, was that Ellen or the Bible? Ellen or the Bible? It was a very common question among people I knew.
They morphed and it almost didn't matter.
It didn't matter because we knew that Ellen was just expanding on the Bible. God had given her special revelation, which is what the Desire of Ages is all about.
Oh, yeah.
She made the story more beautiful because she got to fill in the white space. God showed her. He took her and showed her this rainbow snake with wings, and she had all of this other special information. So what did she know about heaven? What's that going to be like?
Right.
So that was kind of how I learned about heaven as an Adventist, which I was always learning but never coming to truth.
Yes, that so describes how I was. So today we're going to look at these three questions. The first one being, how do we learn about heaven? And we've just shared that we can't quite remember, except it involved Adventist art and Adventist children's books and the water we swam in.
And the prophet.
And the prophet. And the other questions are, what will we be like there and what will we do there? So I think that we're going to look first at this first question, how do we learn about it? And today, in today's culture, within Christianity, there is a lot of confusion about how we know about heaven mm-hmm. and who's authoritative to tell us about heaven. And you wouldn't think that would be an issue. And we who came out of Adventism think, well, okay, we have to learn to get Ellen White out of our heads. But you know, Ellen White isn't the only person who claimed to have visions of heaven. Mm-hmm. Adventists aren't the only people who believe extra-biblical sources of what heaven is about. So how can we know what to believe? That's the big question. So Nikki, what was your takeaway as we listened to Pastor Gary reteach this session? What does he take us to as our foundation place to start this search?
Well, true to form, he took us to Scripture.
I know, right?
And the central passage that we're going to look at comes out of 2 Corinthians in chapter 12. But the context is really interesting. And some of the stuff that Pastor Gary shared with us about the context of Corinthians was helpful
yeah.
in understanding why Paul went into kind of a rant that he didn't want to go into.
Right.
About what he saw in heaven. Mm-hmm. Pastor Gary said that 2 Corinthians is the most autobiographical book that Paul writes. He wrote his letters to the church in Corinth, and they had been a really big challenge to him at that time. He loved them deeply. That's clear in the letter, but this is the church that concerned him the most. Although I would say that Galatians gave them a run for yes. their money. but Gary called the church at Corinth Paul's prodigal child.
Yeah.
That was kind of how he described them.
And I will never forget Elizabeth Inrig telling us years ago in Women's Bible Study, the church at Corinth was a true church, true mm-hmm. believers, but that by the year 100 AD, it had ceased to exist.
Oh, how sad.
It is sad. Paul wrote this book around the year 55.
And the problem was that the church had been invaded by false teachers who were seeking the praise of others and who were constantly boasting about their experiences. Now we hear that and it's like, oh, how obnoxious.
Yeah.
But apparently this was something that was really valued in Greek thought. Mm-hmm. Boasting about your experiences was respected. It was the humble that was looked down on
right.
in this Greek philosophy.
And the experiences that they were boasting of were these spiritual, heightened spiritual experiences or revelations or insights. And that kind of came from the Greek idea that spirit was what was actually real and the physical was just a shadow of the spiritual. This is what Adventists latch onto and call Greek dualism, and they say that's what Christianity let infiltrate them so that people believe that people have an immaterial spirit. This is where they get that idea that Greek dualism is a corruption of the Bible and a corruption of the nature of man. But that's just plain wrong.
Well, it's a redefinition of what's going on.
Exactly.
Paul called them false apostles because these teachers were claiming to have connection with important people in Jerusalem. They were claiming to be apostles, but actually they were just bullies.
Yeah.
So he's forced to respond to them. He's forced to respond to their Greek ideology of boasting and self-promotion. And he does this in a way where he boasts about his sufferings. So yeah. he flips it.
Isn't that interesting? I used to read these passages in 2 Corinthians and think, you know, why would Paul even talk this way? Why would he even say, okay, I hate to boast, I don't want to boast, but I will. Mm-hmm. And I'd think, so why? But that's the reason.
He's modeling the truth. He's turning it on its head.
Yeah. And this church had been infiltrated by false teachers. And at this point in my experience, Nikki, I have so much sympathy for him. I know how hard it is to look at a group of people who have been totally shaped by a false teacher, to think that they're superior because of it.
Mm-hmm.
And Paul is saying, I have to do something. I have to speak up. I have to tell them that what I've told them is credible.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting that we're dealing with this. I recently had somebody comment on their frustration over my boasting that I'm saved. And the thing of it is when you really truly grasp the gospel, mm-hmm. any boasting in salvation is a boasting and making much of Christ and his finished work.
Yeah.
It has nothing to do with the sinner, with the person
right.
who has been saved. It is Christ alone who saves. And so we boast in Christ and the incredible faithfulness that he offers us when he keeps us in salvation by his power through faith.
Yeah. And we have his life. It's not just that we've suddenly had new light or Gnostic knowledge or
right.
enlightenment. No, he gives us himself.
Yeah.
He brings us to life. That's salvation.
Yeah. And it doesn't come until we can acknowledge with humility our absolute need and depravity.
That's true.
And that's what Paul is doing. He's boasting in his weakness. It's a great theme in Corinthians, the power of weakness. In 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 30, just before he goes into chapter 12, Paul says, "If I have to boast, I will boast of what pertains to my weakness."
Yeah. So then he goes into what becomes his defense against the false prophets and against the false teachers. He is explaining to the Corinthians why they can believe the gospel that he's taught them, why he is not inferior to these people who come in claiming to have special revelations and special experiences with God. And I want to say at the same time, today we hear so much from people of charismatic groups that are looking for experiences, looking for manifestations of the Spirit, looking for visions and insights and dreams and understandings, people who are casting out demons from one another or naming the spirits of whatever and getting rid of them. None of these are models we find in the Bible. And Paul is going to explain how he is more credible than the people who came in and taught them to try to behave this way. Do you want to go ahead and read the passage from 2 Corinthians 12 where Paul explains what happened to him?
Yeah. So 2 Corinthians 12, 1 through 7, "It is necessary to boast, though it is not profitable, but I will go on to visions and revelations of the Lord. I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago, whether in the body I do not know or out of the body I do not know, God knows, such a man was caught up to the third heaven. And I know how such a man, whether in the body or apart from the body, I do not know, God knows, was caught up to paradise and heard inexpressible words, which a man is not permitted to speak. On behalf of such a man, I will boast, but on my own behalf, I will not boast except in weakness. For if I do wish to boast, I will not be foolish, for I will be speaking the truth. But I refrain from this so that no one will consider me beyond what he sees in me or hears from me. Because of the surpassing greatness of the revelations, for this reason, to keep me from exalting myself, there was given me a thorn in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me, to keep me from exalting myself."
Well, in this passage, we see that Paul is telling us that he had an experience and he is so hesitant to talk about it. And apparently, the context suggests he's never talked about this before. He's never told the people this before. He's had this experience in which God taught him things about heaven, but you know what? He doesn't tell us what they are. And this is not something that he made up, but he is finally saying that he had the experience in order to sort of give him street cred with the Corinthians, because they're falling.
Mm-hmm.
On their faces in front of these false teachers and prophets who've had all kinds of revelations and they feel so special. And I want to say, I get it. I kind of understand that.
Well, and it's interesting too, because these guys are saying, "Hey, we're apostles. We know the apostles." And Paul's coming in saying, "I'm Paul.
Uh-huh.
I'm Paul the apostle. And this is all I'm allowed to tell you." And he didn't even want to call himself out at the beginning, although he does in verse 7, doesn't he?
Yes, he does.
I used to wonder, why do so many people think that Paul's talking about himself here?
I did too.
Where did that come from?
Mm-hmm.
But it's clear in verse 7, he says, "Because of the surpassing greatness of the revelations, for this reason to keep me from exalting myself, there was given a thorn in the flesh."
Yeah.
So those revelations were given to him.
To him. And I think it's really interesting, and this is just an aside, this is a little special Adventist aside that was meaningful to me. This particular letter, as we mentioned, was written about 55 AD, and his experience of being taken to heaven, whether in the body or out, he didn't know, was 14 years previously. This is the letter that contains 2 Corinthians 5:1 to 9 that says, we live in a mortal tent, and to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord, and we make it our aim to please him, whether in the body or out of it. Mm-hmm. This passage of 2 Corinthians 5, Paul is writing with authority on the basis of having been taken to heaven and shown things he can't explain to us. Mm-hmm. So when I realized that, I thought, okay, this is not just wishful thinking or Paul understanding or putting into words some thought he had or some half-formed idea based on some obscure Old Testament text. This is something that he knew because he was taken to heaven.
Isn't that interesting? Because as an Adventist, I never thought of Paul having visions.
I didn't either.
I thought of him writing in his historical context. It was Ellen who had all the visions.
Right.
And in fact, it's the other way around. Paul had the vision given by God. Ellen White was writing from a historical context.
Yes.
And if she did have visions, they weren't from God.
No, they clearly weren't because they contradict the Bible. So we see here that this vision, which occurred around maybe 40 AD, was less than 10 years after Jesus' ascension. So this is very, very early in the life of the brand new church. And what is so significant is that Paul wasn't allowed by Jesus himself. He wasn't allowed to tell what he saw. He wasn't allowed to talk about it. He wasn't allowed to tell what he heard. In fact, it was so important that he not feel puffed up by having been shown these things, or to be tempted to tell, I would suggest, that God gave him a thorn in the flesh. Do we know what that is?
No, we don't. But a lot of people have guessed. I've even heard people suggest it was a wife.
I have too. I've heard people suggest other very strange things too. Some have suggested that it could have been a chronic eye condition, because when he wrote Galatians, he said, when I came to you, you would have done anything for me. You would have given me your own eyes if you could have. So we know that he came to them with some kind of a health concern that involved his eyes. We don't know if that was related or not.
No, we don't. And I have heard people suggest also that it may have had something to do with a stutter, because he says in Corinthians, I did not come with eloquent words of wisdom, but with fear and trembling and in the power of the Holy Spirit. All we can do is speculate. We don't really know.
Right.
But what we do know for absolute certain is that it was a messenger of Satan, which again shows us God's sovereignty even over Satan and his minions.
That's really important. God sent a messenger of Satan to Paul to be a thorn in his flesh to keep him from getting puffed up over the great things he had seen in this vision.
And I also think significant to our conversation today is to point out the fact that it wasn't just that Paul was not permitted to speak these things. Paul said that he heard inexpressible words which a man is not permitted to speak. So any man is not permitted to speak these things, and yet we do have quite the lineage of people who have claimed to be Christians who have seen things and come back and talk about them.
That's true. So I think we learn a lot from this particular passage. This needs to give us pause. There is a long history within the Christian tradition of people having visions or experiences where they claim to see heaven or things in heaven or angels or saints, beginning with Catholicism. Catholicism has a very long history of spiritual experiences, extra-biblical revelations. They have a legacy of things that they call the beatific visions.
Mm-hmm.
How would you describe a beatific vision?
So the way Gary talked about the beatific visions is that they were visions about heaven, purgatory, and hell. And he talked about some of the apparitions of Mary.
Mm-hmm.
He said that some of the famous ones are Our Lady of Guadalupe, Fatima, and Our Lady of Medjugorje. I don't know if I said that right. It's in Eastern Europe. So these are some of the common ones that you can look up and learn about. Very rich in the history of Roman Catholicism. In addition to the culture surrounding Roman Catholicism and the visions that they had, we also have a fascination with near-death experiences, where you have people who don't even claim to be Christian, who are having these experiences of heaven. This dates all the way back to the 18th century. There are records in medieval periods and other stories that go back into distant history, but it was really popularized in 1969 by a woman named Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, who wrote a book on death and dying. And she's actually the one who wrote about the five stages of grief,
which we've often talked about here. Actually, after putting it together with what she said in general about near-death experiences, I got to wondering if I really want to refer to her anymore. But there really are stages people pass through when they experience grief. So I'm not recommending her as a reliable source, just saying.
Yeah, she was just observing something that we can all observe.
Yeah.
But she did make a big impact in the way that we care for the dying. Because this is what was surrounding her life, she ultimately became fascinated with near-death experiences. And she began to get involved closer and closer to those who have them, which actually brought her into seances and occult practices, talking to spirit guides and claiming her own out-of-body experiences. So the more fascinated she became with near-death experiences, the deeper and deeper she went into the occult.
Which I think is so interesting, Nikki. If you read Paul in what we just read, 2 Corinthians 12, that's not going to lead you into the occult. It's going to make you realize that God is higher than we are, that we can trust him, and that we can trust Paul. But it's not a thing where we get more and more fascinated, wanting more and more detail, which is just an interesting thing I'd never thought about before thinking about this woman being drawn in like that.
Yeah, Paul's writing on this redirects the Christian to submission to God and to scripture and humility. To walking out their faith in obedience to Christ. The fascination of the flesh and indulging in that curiosity just takes you down some dark roads.
It does.
And that seems to be the pattern.
In 1975 was the next big contribution to this near-death experience movement, if you want to call it that. It was by Dr. Raymond Moody, and he wrote the book Life After Life. Now, his book kicked off a whole new interest in near-death experiences. It actually became a discipline of study. Now, near-death experiences is a discipline of study that has international conferences, curricula. It became a whole academic focus, if you want to call it that, that people still pursue and try to figure out. In his work, Dr. Moody noticed that many people claimed that they had died and had a series of different experiences related to their spirits leaving their bodies. And then they somehow came back and were able to talk about these experiences and what their spirits supposedly saw and what they felt. As he listened to these people, a couple of things really struck me as interesting. One was Dr. Moody became convinced there was no judgment after death. What's so interesting is that about 25% of people who have near-death experiences actually report that their experiences are not positive. They're frightening, negative experiences. But somehow Moody managed not to quote them or include them in his book. He only included the positive ones and concluded there's no judgment after death, which is interesting. I'm not sure we can take his word as meaning anything in the big picture except his opinion. However, it is fascinating to me that even his research wasn't honest because he left out that 25%, which is a significant portion of his research. He also later dabbled in soothsaying, crystals, communicating with the dead, and ultimately became enmeshed in a kind of spirituality associated with near-death experiences. And isn't it interesting, Nikki, that this is seeming to be a pattern?
Yeah. Then in 1992, a woman named Betty Eady wrote a book called Embraced by Light. She claimed to be a Christian, and we do know that she had a strict Catholic upbringing. But as of November 5th of 2019, she was a member in good standing with the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. She claimed to have a near-death experience in the hospital, and nobody else was aware that this happened. There was no alarm or medical interventions that were recorded. But interestingly, the vision was all about the pre-existence of lives on the other side.
How very Mormon.
What's interesting to me about all of these people who had all these near-death experiences visiting different places and coming back to talk about it, it really does take me back to a podcast that Jim Baber did on Academy Apologia. I'm just going to mention it and encourage people to check it out. It's his Defeating Adventism number 91, and it's titled Ellen White, Victorian Trance Medium, Seventh-day Adventist Spiritualist. And it's fascinating how similar some of her visions are to these other people. And we'll say a little bit more about Betty Eady as we go on in the connection there. But all of these near-death experiences bring up some legitimate questions. There's commonality between them. There's a list of 15 components of near-death experiences. And you said that there was this study of near-death experiences, and they have come up with this list. And they will grade a person, and if they get 7 out of the 15, then they'll consider it a near-death experience. There's a whole test for this.
Isn't that interesting? And I find 7 out of 15 to be an interesting number.
It is.
Because it's not quite half. You don't have to have a whole lot of the list to be considered a near-death. You can deviate. How do you decide?
We also know that the themes that people bring back are inevitably shaped by their pre-experiences, their religious backgrounds, or their religious understanding or culture. So that's also interesting. People will claim very similar kinds of experiences, but they interpret them differently based on where they're from.
Yeah.
Many have a figure of light that they meet on the other side, and a number of them don't. So what are these? Are they imagined events?
Neurological phenomenon or
demonic events?
Divine events?
These are all really interesting questions. Gary raised them, but I think we all kind of play with them in our head when we hear about this. What is this? What is it that these people are experiencing? Well, people increasingly became fascinated with these near-death experiences. And of course, that meant there was a way to make money on this.
Oh, you bet. There's kind of a name that was given to this phenomenon as it began to increase and get published around the year 2000, something that our pastor called the heavenly tourism boom began to happen. And you may remember some of these books. I remember hearing about them. I didn't read any of them, but some of them became a bit infamous. For example, the man named Don Piper wrote about his 90 Minutes in Heaven. Now, some of you have heard of that book. You may have read it. I personally didn't. But he wrote about what happened to him after he had an accident, had been declared dead, and he claimed to have been in heaven for 90 minutes. He says he didn't see Jesus or God, but he did see deceased friends and family, and he heard wonderful music.
And I believe they made a movie based on this book.
Yes, which is a really interesting thing. And his book itself sold 6 million copies. I mean, it tells you how fascinated people are with this whole subject.
Another book was called Heaven is for Real by Todd Burpo. That one sold 10 million copies. And in this book, his 3-year-old son died from a ruptured appendix and then came back to life. They made a movie about it, which made $100 million. So the boy's father was a pastor in the Wesleyan Methodist context, and as the boy grew older, he began to talk to his father about certain things that he saw when he was dead at the age of 3.
Yeah.
He said he saw his granddad and his sister, who he shouldn't have known about because she was, I think, stillborn, and they hadn't told him about her. Mm-hmm. And he said he saw Jesus and that Jesus had a rainbow pony.
Isn't that interesting?
And the Holy Spirit is kind of a blue light. Some of what the boy said was 6 or 7 years after the event.
Think about a child, your own children perhaps, or your grandkids, or yourself as a child. A child would not necessarily have the words to speak about a lot of things that they would see in a situation like this. It's fascinating. He had the detail that Jesus had a rainbow pony. But as he talked over the years, you'd have to conclude that this child had heard things from his family too. I mean, if he has a pastor father, he's hearing about heaven, he's hearing about death. And you sometimes never know how many of these details that children hear get incorporated into their minds. You know, just like you asked me, Nikki, how did I learn about heaven? I can't remember, but I do remember pictures. And I do know that I had books read to me. And I do know that I heard people talking. So this child was 3 when this happened. And based on my own children and based on my grandchildren, a 3-year-old certainly knows what may be going on, but is limited in their speech capabilities sometimes. So some are precocious. but it would be hard to get a real definitive conversation going about details of what happened in a near-death experience from a three-year-old. So it's fascinating that the details kept coming out over the next 6 or 7 years.
Yeah. The next one is actually my favorite because it it includes a confession and a repentance. So Kevin Malarkey had a young son, Alex Malarkey, who was permanently paralyzed in a terrible car accident, and he had a near-death experience. He claimed he went to heaven, and his father wrote a book on that basis. But Alex eventually released an open letter to Christian publishers and bookstores saying it was all fictional, and he implored them to remove the book from their stores. The book was called The Boy Who Came Back from Heaven. And I want to read to you his letter. He said, "Please forgive the brevity, but because of my limitation, I have to keep this short. I did not die. I did not go to heaven. I said I went to heaven because I thought it would get me attention. When I made the claims that I did, I had never read the Bible. People have profited from lies and continue to. They should read the Bible, which is enough. The Bible is the only source of truth. Anything written by man cannot be infallible. It is only through repentance of your sins and a belief in Jesus as the Son of God who died for your sins, even though he committed none of his own, so that you could be forgiven, that you may learn of heaven what is written in the Bible, not by reading a book of man. I want the whole world to know that the Bible is sufficient. Those who market these materials must be called to repent and to hold the Bible as enough. Signed, In Christ." And the publishers actually withdrew the book.
It's interesting to me, too, that this boy's mother was the first person to complain that this was a false reporting. And that the long game was that the father became separated from the family over this. The father is the one who had written the book and had used essentially his son's accident as a moneymaker. Mm. So over the years, books about heaven, books about people seeing Jesus and so forth in near-death experiences have sold enormously. In fact, Todd Burpo said, "I always believed in heaven, but now I know it's real," as he listened to his three-year-old say that he had seen Jesus on the rainbow pony. Mm-hmm. But it's interesting that this Alex Malarkey, who wrote the letter of repentance and called the publisher to withdraw his book, he said the truth in that letter. He said, "Those who market these books should read the Bible. The Bible must be enough." And I want to say, that's the message for Adventists. We have to consider this. We had a prophet who told us things that she saw in visions where she was supposedly in heaven and she reported what she saw there. Paul the Apostle did not tell us what he saw in heaven. He wasn't permitted to. How can we think that anybody else is going to be able to tell us the truth about heaven if God did not allow his primary New Testament author to tell us?
So I'm going to tell you what I would have said to that as an Adventist. I would have said, if God chose to let Ellen White see these things, to share them with us and encourage us, what difference does it make? All of our doctrines come from the Bible. But actually, and we're going to prove today, that one of their most fundamental doctrines that they base their three angels gospel message on came from one of Ellen White's visions to heaven.
That's right. Ellen White, as we all know, is considered the prophetic voice of Seventh-day Adventism. So when did all of this start? Well, she had her first vision when she was 17 years old. Now, some people say that she had an unofficial vision earlier, that there are records of her having one earlier. But the Adventist organization generally says that she had her first vision at age 17 during the Millerite movement. She claimed to have had 2,000 visions, about 200 directly related to heaven. And in one of them, she claims, and this is one of her early ones, she claims she saw the New Jerusalem.
Coming out of heaven through the belt of Orion. The belt of Orion is significant in Adventism, as many of us know, because it's either the place through which the New Jerusalem comes, or it's the place where heaven actually is. And in one of her visions, she was taken to Saturn and Jupiter, and she saw various moons and reported them back. But the numbers of the moons that she saw were inaccurate. We know better now. However, they were exactly the numbers most people believed existed at that particular time. She was going off of common knowledge to describe these visions.
Now, I find that really interesting and really annoying because if she were really a prophet of God, she wouldn't have been shown the wrong number of moons. This was opportunistic. This was opportunistic because she was trying to get specific people to believe she had real visions. And especially important among these people she was trying to convince was Joseph Bates, who became one of the three founders of Seventh-day Adventism. Now, Joseph Bates was older than James White, older than Ellen White, and he had a past as a sea captain. He had money. Mm-hmm. He was the wealthy one. He was the one who funded the printing and the foundation of the Adventist movement. He was useful to James, who had a very distinct entrepreneurial talent. So the two of them worked together, and Ellen was the one who gave the word from the Lord to put authority to the things that they came up with. Now, here's what I found really interesting, and I want to do a shout out to an article by Martin Carey that was run in the 2009 third edition of Proclamation. And it was called Opening Orion. We're going to put a link in the show notes to this particular article because it's extremely well documented and extremely revealing. But in a nutshell, here's what happened. Joseph Bates had money, and he was compelled because he had started listening to William Miller in 1839, and he had become a Millerite. He met James White and he met Ellen White during this time, but he didn't really believe Ellen had real visions. Mm-hmm. James, of course, seeing the potential of Joseph's money, had to figure out a way to convince him. So what happened was, in May of 1846, Joseph Bates had written a tract called The Opening Heavens. Now, he was somewhat of an amateur astronomer for his day. He had become quite familiar with the stars and the constellations because of his history as a sea captain. And he was kind of fascinated with all of this, kind of like a lot of people are with the near-death experiences. He was quite fascinated with this. So in 1846, he had published this tract in which he theorized that the references to the New Jerusalem descending out of heaven, that this descent was coming through one location, the middle star of Orion's sword. And he said this in his tract: "From what part of heaven will this glorious city appear? We answer, from where the flaming sword is guarding the way of the tree of life." Martin Carey's article from the 2009 Volume 3 issue of Proclamation says this, and it's interesting because it gives us a setting. Now remember, Joseph Bates's pamphlet on the opening heavens was written in May of 1846. Here's what Martin Carey writes. "In November of 1846, 5 months after publishing his tract, Bates was invited to a conference with the newly married Ellen and James White in Topsham, Maine. Bates knew of Ellen's visions, but questioned their authenticity. At this conference, he watched Ellen White in vision traveling to other planets and beyond. She described a gap in the sky of great beauty, framed by four stars appearing like gates, with bright glory shining through. Bates became very excited and exclaimed, 'She is giving a more wonderful description than any astronomer ever dreamed of.' Because White had not demonstrated any knowledge of astronomy, Bates never suspected that the Whites might have read his tract. Hearing Ellen's glorious description of the gap, Bates was convinced that her visions were from God. He was so impressed, in fact, that he wished Lord Rosse, builder of the world's then largest telescope, had been there to hear her. Bates believed that Rosse had seen the gap with his giant telescope, and he was certain that White's description would have deeply impressed him. Ellen's vision of the opening was decisive in bringing Bates, with his strong positions against the Trinity, four Sabbath observance, the state of the dead, and temperance into the Adventist movement. The opening in Orion, therefore, had a role not only in shaping Adventist eschatology, but also even more profoundly in gathering together its founders and fundamental beliefs.
And that was a pattern with Ellen.
Yes.
In D.M. Canwright's book on the life and sketches of Ellen G. White, he talks about the fact that Elder Bates became convinced of Saturday Sabbath observance and that he brought this to James and Ellen, and they weren't convinced at first.
That's right.
But they needed some money. And according to D.M. Canwright, there was a deal that was struck, and she would support his Sabbath doctrine and he would support their traveling and publishing. So then Ellen White had a vision about the Sabbath and the importance and the necessity of Sabbath keeping.
And that brings us to her all-important vision of the temple, the sanctuary, the ark in heaven.
This is taken from Life Sketches. Elder Bates was resting on Saturday, the seventh day of the week, and he urged it upon our attention as the true Sabbath. I didn't feel its importance and thought he erred in dwelling on the fourth commandments more than upon the other nine, but the Lord gave me a view of the heavenly sanctuary. The temple of God was opened in heaven, and I was shown the ark of God covered with the mercy seat. Two angels stood, one at either end of the ark, with their wings spread over the mercy seat and their faces turned toward it. This, my accompanying angel informed me, represented all the heavenly hosts looking with reverential awe toward the law of God, which had been written by the finger of God. Jesus raised the cover of the ark, and I beheld the tablets of stone on which the Ten Commandments were written. I was amazed as I saw the fourth commandment in the very center of the ten precepts with a soft halo of light encircling it. Said the angel, "It is the only one of the ten which defines the living God who created the heavens and the earth and all the things that are therein. When the foundations of the earth were laid, then was also laid the foundation of the Sabbath. I was shown that if the true Sabbath had been kept, there would have never been an infidel or an atheist. The observance of the Sabbath would have preserved the world from idolatry. The fourth commandment has been trampled upon. Therefore, we are called upon to repair the breach in the law and plead for the desecrated Sabbath. The man of sin who exalted himself above God and thought to change times and laws brought about the change of the Sabbath from the seventh to the first day of the week. In doing this, he made a breach in the law of God. Just prior to the great day of God, a message is sent forth to warn the people to come back to their allegiance to the law of God, which Antichrist has broken down. Attention must be called to the breach in the law by precept and example. It was shown that the precious promises of Isaiah 58:12-14 apply to those who labor for the restoration of the true Sabbath. I was shown that the third angel proclaiming the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus represents the people who receive this message and raise the voice of warning to the world to keep the commandments of God and his law as the apple of the eye, and that in response to this warning, many would embrace the Sabbath of the Lord.
Okay, so what's wrong with this picture?
Well, all of it. But they have completely recreated a new gospel message, a new call, a new command for salvation. Mm-hmm. Keep the Sabbath. Mm-hmm. All based on a vision that she ended up having after Elder Bates brought up the idea of Sabbath keeping.
That's correct. When they needed Elder Bates's money.
And here's the thing, Colleen. This is what's so hard about the work that we do. Many Adventists who say, I don't believe Ellen. I don't read Ellen. Mm-hmm. But the Bible says to keep the Sabbath. And I do it because I love God. Okay, that's an argument that came from Ellen.
Yes.
But if you're a Seventh-day Adventist, you are funding, participating in, promoting, and raising your children inside of a system that has created a doctrine off of a false vision and a false prophet with a false gospel and a false call.
Not to mention a false interpretation of Revelation 14 with the three angels' messages. Bears no resemblance to keeping the Sabbath.
That's not the gospel call.
No. Sabbath was introduced on the basis of an extra-biblical vision. It's just shocking. The thing that Paul was not allowed to do, Ellen did. She claims to tell exactly what she saw. She claims Jesus was involved and that there was a light around the fourth commandment.
Jesus wasn't very dominant in the vision. All he did was move something aside so she could see the halo on the fourth commandment.
Yes, because the law is the all-important thing. And that struck me as I listened to you read this vision again. It's the law. And this is where the dominance of the law comes into Seventh-day Adventism. It comes from Ellen's vision of heaven, which no one is permitted to do and speak of. What we need to know is given in the scripture. And you know, Adventists will say, well, Ellen doesn't contradict scripture. She points me back to the Bible. No. This is not pointing back to the Bible. In fact, I rather loved what our pastor said about this. He said, she claimed that the angels in her vision looked with reverential awe toward the law of God, that they beheld the tablets of stone, and she saw the soft halo of light encircling the fourth commandment. And he pointed out that in Revelation 4 and 5, the angels are clearly portrayed as worshiping the Lamb who has been slain, the Lamb who has fulfilled the law and abolished the Sabbath. There are no angels in heaven pictured anywhere in the New Testament looking reverentially at the law of God and singing praises to the law and endorsing the keeping of the Sabbath. They are exalting Jesus, who said he came to fulfill the law. And the New Testament confirms that he came to fulfill the law. The Sabbath is done in Christ. And then for her to say, if the Sabbath had been kept, there would never have been an infidel or an atheist.
That's
Nikki,
something.
How do you even get there?
Well, God told her, apparently.
Apparently. Except I think it was the wrong God. It was the Adventist God.
It was also interesting that the angel told her that the fourth commandment is the only one that defines the living God. But what about the first commandment?
Well, you know, they don't tell us in Adventism that the Ten Commandments don't begin with Exodus 20, verse 3, which says, thou shalt have no other gods before me. The Ten Commandments begin with the prologue, which begins in Exodus 20, verse 2. And here's what it says. I am Yahweh, your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. Well, the Adventists claim that the fourth commandment is the only place where God reveals his identity and his authority and what he is powerful over and the reason we are to remember him. And they say that it's because in the fourth commandment, it says he is the creator of heaven and earth. But right at the beginning of the Decalogue, he identifies himself. They didn't tell us that.
No, and it's interesting too, because he identifies himself in the fourth commandment the same way in the re-giving of the law.
In Deuteronomy, mm-hmm. Deuteronomy 5. In Deuteronomy 5, the creation is not mentioned at all in connection with the fourth commandment. So we have God revealing himself first as Yahweh, the Redeemer, the Savior who rescued his people from Egypt, from slavery. And then he says, you shall have no other gods before me. And it was interesting to hear Pastor Carey say, if the creation part of this had been that important, why didn't Moses refer to it again in Deuteronomy 5? The reference there, again, is to his action as Redeemer who saves them from slavery.
And here's where I can hear all of the arguments going on in the back of my head. We are not saying that God as creator is not important.
That's right.
What I would say is that the Ten Commandments is not the transcript of God's character. Jesus Christ is.
That's right.
And we know that he is creator and redeemer.
That's exactly it. The fourth commandment was never intended to give an eternal command and make a day eternally holy, or to declare a day to be eternally holy. It was intended as a sign for Israel. And we learn that in Exodus 31, 13. It is a sign between God and Israel throughout their generations. It is not a sign for anybody but Israel. Mm-hmm. And it was never an eternally holy day. God is the Holy One, and He identified Himself. He didn't need the fourth commandment to do that.
No. And Jesus is the one who came to reveal the Father. That's He came right. to reveal truth. In Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1, we read, "Long ago, at many times and in many ways, God spoke to us by the prophets. But in these last days, He has spoken to us through His Son."
That's right.
The last days beginning with the death and resurrection of Christ.
That's correct.
So we have the final word. We have the full revelation of God in the man Christ Jesus, in the incarnate Son of God. The full revelation of God. And He is the one who tells us the truth about these things, about heaven, about hell. He's the source. So when we ask, where do we get our information about heaven? Our answer is no longer art,
right?
Oral tradition,
no.
Heavenly tourism or near-death experiences. The answer is one that Jesus gave to Nicodemus in John 3, verses 12 and 13. He said, "If I told you earthly things and you do not believe them, how will you believe if I tell you heavenly things? And no one has ascended to heaven but He who descended from heaven, the Son of Man." It is to Jesus and Jesus only that we go to for this information.
It's so ironic that Adventism will set up the fourth commandment as stated in Exodus 20, verses 8 to 11, and not mention Deuteronomy 5, and create a whole argument to convince a whole organization that the Sabbath is holy and must be kept if we're going to honor Jesus. And yet, at the beginning, we have God revealing Himself as Yahweh, who rescues them, who saves them, and then says, "You shall have no other gods before Me." And in effect, Adventism has created another God that they honor before Jesus. They have created an entire eschatology that says their entire fitness for heaven will be judged on the basis of the law, particularly the fourth commandment, and they will be judged on the basis of whether or not they're willing to keep the law to the point of death. The New Testament is very clear that we honor God by being loyal to Him, by being born again, and not renouncing Him. It's not about putting a day in there as any sort of a sign or seal. That comes before Jesus in an Adventist mind. And I say this from having been Adventist, who really wanted to serve Jesus, but the Sabbath was always blurring who He was. It's written into the doctrines.
The doctrines that clearly came from a vision. And the thing is when we make a statement, we Christians make a statement about the inspiration of the Bible, we're making a statement about the sufficiency of the Bible. That's one of the attributes of Scripture, that it is sufficient. And when you have to add to the biblical worldview all of the musings and visions and ideas of a prophetess, you are essentially admitting that you are not a Protestant. You do not believe that the Bible is sufficient. And the thing that is so difficult about the work we do is that Seventh-day Adventism masquerades as Protestant Christianity. And I know as an Adventist, I would have told you, no, I keep the Sabbath because it's a blessing. I keep the Sabbath as a lifestyle. I don't think Christians who don't keep the Sabbath are not going to be saved. They'll be saved. I would argue all of those points without understanding that I was participating in a false system.
Yeah.
And I was holding unexamined dualistic thinking because I also was terrified that I would one day give up the Sabbath and lose my salvation.
I was in the same boat. Oh my goodness. This is a very interesting point, Nikki. We had an idol and didn't have any idea it was an idol. We thought the Sabbath was the sign and the seal that was the visible evidence that we were loyal to God. But you notice in this vision that Ellen White had, the center of her attention and the center of Adventist attention is the Ten Commandments.
Glowing in glory, like we read about the New Jerusalem.
And the New Testament, the book of Hebrews, the book of Galatians, the book of Colossians is very, very clear that Sabbath keeping is no longer required because Jesus has fulfilled the law and everything is in Him. We are His if we trust Him and are born again. That is how we will be measured for salvation. We will be looked at as to whether we are alive in Christ or not, not about whether we are observing the Sabbath and the Decalogue. Because the Decalogue is incorporated into who Jesus is, what He has done, and His new covenant in His blood. People are not judged by the Ten Commandments. Believers who are alive in Christ have already been judged because Jesus took our judgment on the cross. And when we are alive in Christ, we are transferred out of death into life. That is what Jesus said in John 5:24. People who are not believers will not be judged for salvation on the basis of the law either. They will be judged on the basis of what they do with Christ. Have they trusted the finished atonement of His blood, His death, His burial, and His resurrection? That is who judges the world. Jesus Himself is the judge of the earth, and if we are in Him, we have passed and do not come into judgment. We have passed from death to life. But if we have not trusted Him, it is that that causes the wrath of God to remain on us because we are dead in sin.
So now we're going to quickly go through some things that the Bible tells us about what heaven will be like. And I'm going to go kind of quickly because we've gone long, but this was really important for us to explore because it's not something all Adventists are aware of, that beliefs come from the visions of Ellen. The first thing we know is that we will be physically new and glorious because we will have our resurrection bodies. This is speaking of the new heavens and the new earth. And the text for this is Philippians 3, verses 20 and 21. For our citizenship is in heaven, from which also we eagerly wait for a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform the body of our humble state into conformity with the body of His glory by His working through which He is able to even subject all things to Himself.
Number two, we will be spiritually new and glorious. And we know from Romans 8, 29 and 30 that God has already predestined us to the image of His Son. It says, because those whom He foreknew, He also predestined to become conformed to the image of His Son, so that He who would be the firstborn among many brothers, and those whom He predestined, He also called, and those whom He called, He also justified, and those whom He justified, He also glorified. That glorified is in the past tense. It is as good as done. It is an absolute promise.
And we also saw that in Revelation chapter 22, verse 4 and 5. And they will see His face, and His name will be on their foreheads, and there will no longer be any night, for they will not have need of the light of a lamp nor the light of the sun, because the Lord God will illumine them, and they will reign forever and ever.
Number three, we will be personally new and glorious. We will not be perfect in the sense of being divine. We will always have a distinction between who we are and who God is. But we will be new, we will be without sin, and we will not be clones. We will be ourselves made new.
Yes, and I love the verse that Pastor Carey pointed us to for that. It's taken all the way back from Job chapter 19. I wish I knew how he knew this. Verses 25 and 27, Job said, "As for me, I know that my Redeemer lives. And at the last, He will rise up over the dust of this world. Even after my skin is destroyed, yet from my flesh, I shall behold God, whom I myself shall behold, and whom my eyes will see, and not another. My heart faints within me."
We will also know joy in heaven, and Psalm 16:11 confirms this. "You will make known to me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. In your right hand, there are pleasures forevermore."
And again, in Isaiah 35, verse 10, "And the ransomed of Yahweh will return and come with joyful shouting to Zion, with everlasting gladness upon their heads. They will attain delight and gladness. Sorrow and sighing will flee away."
Number four, we will be intellectually new and glorious. And I loved the consideration of 1 Corinthians 13, 9 to 12 as an evidence of this. For we know in part and we prophesy in part, but when the perfect comes, the partial will be done away. When I was a child, I used to speak as a child, think like a child, reason like a child. When I became a man, I did away with childish things, for now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I will know fully, just as I have also been fully known.
And I love that Carey pointed out that God is inexhaustible and we will spend all of eternity learning more of him and never arriving to the end of him.
Number five, we will be relationally new and glorious. We will have new capacity for relationships. This is also related to what we just read when Paul talks about what it means that we will know as we are known. This applies to God. It applies to one another. We will even know angels. Paul tells us we will rule over angels. Whatever that means, we don't fully know, but we will know them in order to do that.
Yes, and the sixth one is that we will be locationally new and glorious. And for more on that, you can go listen to our last podcast on the new heavens and the new earth.
And finally, we will be vocationally new and glorious. If our identity on earth is still in some way part of us and the Lord made us like we are, if there's some continuity between who we are now and who we are then even though it's a bit speculative, we might consider the fact that there's some way in which who God made us to be here will still be part of who we are there.
Oh, absolutely. And the text in Revelation says that we will reign with him forever. Reigning does not imply simply sitting and doing nothing.
No.
Worship includes action.
Right.
So then we have question number three. What will we do in heaven? And that's related to what you just discussed. First, we will worship without inhibition or distraction. It won't be an eternal church service, as right. Gary pointed out. Everything we do will be worship of God.
And number two, we will have fellowship without interruption, and it will all be launched by the marriage supper of the Lamb. There will be feasting with the patriarchs. These are promises that are given in the Old Testament.
There will be service without exhaustion.
And rest without boredom.
There will be companionship without competition or misunderstanding.
And learning without limitation.
And authority without rivalry.
Isn't that amazing?
Mm-hmm.
Somebody did ask a question. What about aging? Will people get old in heaven? We aren't really told, but it seems likely that there will be some form of maturity with the passing of eternity. For example, children will probably not be children forever. This is only a speculation because it's not specifically stated, but it seems likely that instead of getting weaker like we do now with time, there will be just a kind of maturing without an end to where we go. It will be a place of newness, of growth, and eternal knowing and learning with our God.
And we know this side of eternity that the more we know of God, the more we learn of God, the more we love God, and the more we rejoice and delight in him. And so there will be an emotional and an intellectual maturing that is occurring.
Absolutely so. And if you are thinking about this and pondering things about heaven that you learned as an Adventist and things that you're seeing here in Scripture and seeing that they don't line up, I encourage you to take a very close look again at 2 Corinthians 12. Go and read that passage for yourself. What did Paul say about his experience where the Lord Jesus took him into the third heaven and showed him things he was not permitted to tell? I just appeal to my fellow Adventist, former Adventist family, and those that I hope will be my eternal family in Christ, not to take it for granted that you have special knowledge. The Bible is our only tangible source of reality, and the Holy Spirit is the one who teaches us to apply it to our lives. We have to let go of the extra biblical authority of Ellen White, even if we don't think she's part of who we are. I assure you that if you have been Adventist, she is part of who you are, because all of our Adventist doctrines came from her visions. I know that sounds harsh, but they did. And we've seen how even the Sabbath came through a vision that she conveniently had because they needed Joseph Bates's money. I appeal to you, look to the Lord Jesus. Have you trusted him alone? Have you been willing to say, the Sabbath is something that's standing in my way of putting all of my weight on the finished work of Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection? Bring your sin, bring your deception to him, and ask him to plant you deeply in his word, to show you what is true and real, and to give you the faith to believe. Trust him alone, believe in him, and he will give you new life. He will make you pass from death to life, and you can be certain that you will spend eternity with him, and he will never cast you out.
And join us next week as we continue to walk through the last chapter of the book of Revelation.
We'll see you then.
Thank you for listening to Former Adventist Podcast. You may email us at formeradventist@gmail.com. Former Adventist Podcast is a ministry of Life Assurance Ministries. For more information, weekly articles, videos, and a donation link, go to our website at proclamationmagazine.com.